meeting will come to order. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Our first item is the approval of the agenda.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
I would like to pull table item I from the consent agenda.
Okay.
There's been a few last minute questions, and we would just, in respect of time, we'd like to have 2 more weeks to just have a couple more questions answered before we move forward on that item.
Okay. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Motion by Singwald, second by Beam. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Then I'll make a motion to set the agenda as amended.
Second.
Motion by Singwald, second by Cordes. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Next, we have our superintendent update. Our good news. I'm sorry. We have our good news. We can't miss that.
Good news, and actually, I will turn that over, Madam Chair. Hello, members of the audience, the board.
Is his mic on?
Natalie and Andrew. Yes.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Chair Lee and members of the board. On behalf of Natalie and I, we wanted to do something special for you guys as we concluded our junior board member cycle and kind of transitioned into our senior year board member cycle, so.
Yes, we just wanted to thank you for giving us the opportunity to serve our community as the student school board members. So this represents our student legacy that will continue throughout Farmington.
So we had a plaque made, and it's kind of, we wanted it to kind of be a legacy for all the student board members who are going to come in the future. So what we have here is it has the Farmington Board of Education on it, and then it says, allow student representatives to share their voice and perspective. And we went ahead and we put Natalie Pellin and Andrew Lipkowski, 2013-2014. So hopefully over the years we can just keep adding and kind of have the legacy of the student board member just remembered in a nice way. So we'll pass this around.
Well, that's a great idea. Love that idea.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for doing that.
Is this going up in the high school?
Yeah.
Awesome.
I like it.
Is that all the good news?
Well, that's it.
All right. Then we have the superintendent update.
All right. Well, thanks, Madam Chair. So my update is very brief. It's June, several weeks or after the conclusion of the school year, at least a couple weeks after the conclusion of the school year. Most everyone has had their head down getting ready for this board meeting and really the June 30th, the end of our fiscal year. So the one time I did get everyone together is we had an administrative retreat, which ended up being a working retreat this year. Last week we had all the administrative team together for 2 days. And it was, talking about, you always talk a little bit about the year that's been and debrief that, but then really kind of look to the future. And we have a whole lot of stuff we're going to talk about tomorrow morning to see how to follow up with some really great conversation from the retreat. I think that's really it. Other than that, the agenda speaks for itself. We have 8 fairly weighty items on here tonight, so I look forward to the meeting.
Thank you. We have no public comment tonight, so we'll move on to the consent agenda. The consent agenda is made up of routine business items that can be acted upon with one motion. If any board member wishes to discuss an item, they may request that it be pulled from the consent agenda and it'll be acted upon separately. Does anyone have another item they wish to discuss? Then I'll take a motion.
I'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda as amended.
Second.
Motion by Treacle, second by Saucer. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. We have reports and communications next, and our first report is our MASA update and scholarship with Mr. Gary Amoroso.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the board, members of your community. I'm very honored tonight. I stand before you as the Executive Director of the Minnesota Association of School Administrators. We are the association that has about 900 members, about 600 active administrators in the state. Our largest group is the superintendent group. We have every superintendent, every full-time superintendent in the state as part of our association. We have special education directors as part of our association with a joint relationship with the state special ed group. We have directors of curriculum and instruction. We have other district level administrators in the area of personnel or business. And this year we're adding a new component group, the Technology Leaders of Minnesota, recognizing the fact that no longer is technology a separate course that you have children going to, but it's an integral part of teaching and learning on a daily basis. And so I'm very proud to be here tonight to recognize your superintendent, Mr. Jay Haugen. Jay is completing his year as president of our association. Jay was elected to be the president of the association a year ago. He served the 2013-14 school year as our president-elect. He served this current school year as our president, and he will serve the 2014-15 school year as our past president. I want to thank the board, because I know the board has to be very supportive when one of our members goes on this three-year journey, and we're very grateful that you allowed Jay to take that journey with us and greatly appreciate your support that you provided. With that, we have two tokens of our appreciation. The first, and I'm going to ask Jay to come up here, please. The first presentation is a $1,000 check, and this check can be used by Jay to provide a scholarship for a student in the future, to be used any way Jay wants. So congratulations, sir.
Hey, thanks, Gary.
And we have another token of appreciation from our association. It's a past president's ring. It signifies the work, the time, the effort that Jay has put in, and it can be a memento, hopefully, that as Jay moves forward over the course of the remainder of his career, it'll be a sign of the great leadership that he provided to our association, the same type of leadership that I know he provides to the Farmington School District. Congratulations.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Thank you for coming.
Thanks, Gary. Thanks. Means a lot.
Congratulations.
Well, thank you. Thank you. And if I must say, before Gary steps out, Gary's been a wonderful executive director for us and means a lot, has quite a voice for education. And the best thing to me about belonging to MASA is that when you get together with a group like that, most all of our conversations and our work and our efforts and our strategic plan are all based on improving education and the experience of students across the state. That's what we spend our time on. And so what we have a passion about. It's just great to get everyone together at one time when we do those things. So I'm happy to serve and happy to be past president now too.
And it's exciting to hear about integrating the technology directors.
Yes. So that's been a big thing this year that we got done.
Thank you. All right, next we have our 2013-2014 assessment results with Ms. Sharon Davenport.
Good evening, Madam Chair, Superintendent, members of the board. This evening, we're going to take a look at some of the results from the standardized assessment that Farmington students have taken this past school year. Students in Farmington take assessments or get assessed in various ways throughout the school year. Some of those assessments are classroom assessments done by the teachers. Some are criterion reference tests like our state assessments, and some are standardized tests. And that's what we're going to look at today is these standardized tests, which are nationally normed reference tests. And we have a few different tests to take a look at. One of them is the NWA MAP tests in math and reading that many of our students take a couple times a year. We'll also take a look at the Explore test given to students in grade 8 and the plan test given in students in grade 10. You're probably very familiar with the MCAs, the Minnesota Comprehensive Assessments that our students took most recently. We won't have access to those results just yet. We won't get those till later this summer, so I'll get to come back and share those with you in a few months. But we'll start with the NWA MAP tests. First question, what are they? NWEA is the acronym for the test company, but it's a very familiar acronym, Northwest Evaluation Association. MAP is the acronym for the test itself, measure of academic progress. Those two acronyms often get used interchangeably to represent this test because it is a test that is very common across the country. More than 8 million students across our country have been taking this the last few years. So it's a very popular, well-known test. It is a computer-delivered test that is adaptive, which is a very unique feature of it. As students are taking the test, as they get answers or get questions correct, the test gets a little more difficult. As they get things wrong, it gets a little easier. It is not giving students items based on their grade level. It's giving them items based on their performance on previous items. So students who are performing above grade level can get items well above their grade level. It's finding the level where they're achieving. Students who are struggling will get more items at a lower level to identify where it is they're achieving. And that's the unique feature of this test. It is also nationally normed, as I mentioned just a moment ago. And that means that results are given a comparison to how do other students in the same grade level perform on this same material across the country. All right, so why do we administer these tests in addition to all the other assessments that our kids are having to take? There are two main purposes. We give this test a couple times a year. By giving it in the fall, we get immediate results. Students, when they finish the test, they get a result right away on the screen, and teachers have access to all their students' results within 24 hours on a website. It's immediate feedback, which we don't get in many other tests. It also allows teachers, when they get that immediate feedback, they have information on their students. Where are they right now? And that's a very important piece for diagnostic information. Teachers can use that to make instructional decisions about what their students need. The other piece that is very valuable is by taking this test a couple times a year, we can monitor growth from fall to spring and then from year to year on this continuous scale that this test provides. Who takes these tests? Right now we're administering this test to students, all students in grades 2 through 8, and to most students in grades 9 and 10. At 9 and 10 at the high school, the reading test is administered through the English classes, and all students are taking English 9 or English 10 at some point during the year. Math is a little bit more difficult because there is no grade 9 math class. There's no grade 10 math class. So we're administering the test to the Algebra 1 classes and the geometry classes. Whereas some students might come into high school, they've already surpassed that. So we have some 10th graders who aren't testing because they've already gone into Algebra 2, which is not being tested. So you'll see here in the results, we don't usually include grade 10 because many of your top kids are not taking the test. So an average result wouldn't be including many of your top students, which would not be representative of the whole grade. I do want to mention that when we say all students in grades 2 through 8, that also includes our special education students, our students taking English language, English language learners. We're not pulling anybody out to keep the results higher. We're administering the test to everybody to get a true representation. All right, just in general, our results do demonstrate that achievement does maintain above national norm, which we would expect given our population, but we want to make sure that that is the case. It's important to monitor that. And in many grade levels, our students are performing well above the national norm for the next grade higher. So we'll take a look at that. This first chart is taking a look at our average scores at each grade in both fall and spring for this past school year. The lavender bars represent average fall scores at each grade. The green bars represent average spring scores for Farmington students. The black line running across is the national norm for the fall. So you can get a quick look at where we're close to the national norm or where we're above the national norm in the fall by comparing the lavender to the black. And then the red represents the spring national norm for each grade. So the things I see in here are our growth from fall to spring at each grade by seeing how much improvement. And then also, we've got a bigger change between fall and spring than the national norm at many grade levels. We're showing a bigger jump from the fall to the spring at most grade levels. And then you can see at a number of grade levels, the average spring score is not only above the next grade, but maybe above the grade 2 grades higher, just to give a visual representation of those average scores. So this chart is reading, and this next chart gives very similar information for math. The dark purple represents the fall scores for Farmington students, and the green represents spring. And here, as I mentioned, we don't have an average score for grade 10, but I included the national norm for grade 10 because we like to see that our 7th, 8th, and 9th graders are all showing average achievement at or above that grade 10 level. And that is average achievement. It doesn't mean all our students in 7th, 8th, or 9th are up there. But as an average, we have an average up there above the national average for higher grade levels. We'll also take a quick look, how do these average scores transfer to national percentile ranks? This is a quick look at our average percentile rank for this year, fall and spring, at each grade level. A percentile rank is a comparison to the national average. For example, 61 for grade 2 reading, that's telling us that our average student is performing at or better than 61% of second graders across the country. Again, not all students are at that level, but on average, that is our comparison to the national norm. So in general, we're, again, it's another way of showing that we're above the national average. It's not exactly the same at every grade level, and it's not exactly the same between math and reading, but we have some consistent high achievement. Any questions on those?
Madam Chair?
Yes.
Is there a significant reason why the eighth grade did not take the fall test?
The eighth grade was given the Explore test in the fall. Instead of, we didn't want to double test them. That group took the Explore test instead. And we'll take a look at those results in a minute.
Thank you.
Yep.
And the Explore, just to clarify, is kind of that pre-planned, pre-ACT?
Yes.
It's that?
It's part of the ACT program that gives, it's linked to the ACT. So rather than have them test twice,
thank you,
we gave that one instead. All right, another way we're going to look at these results is looking at change over time. We've now been administering the NWA MAP test for 8 years. So we have quite a bit of data on many of our students and looking at not just one point in time, but what do we have for multiple years? So we're looking at some trends here. This table is just looking at two grade levels, fifth grade and eighth grade, how those fifth graders or eighth graders have done over the past 8 years. I believe a year ago I gave similar charts for every grade, second grade, third grade, fourth grade. I decided not to waste our time with all of those tables. But this gives a quick picture of two examples, because we do see similar patterns at every grade level. The nice thing is we are seeing steady increases year after year. Definitely our fifth graders of today are performing at a higher level than our fifth graders of 8 years ago, and we would like to see that. It's been a steady increase. Now, granted, these are different groups of students, but the steady increase, I do believe, gives us a picture of how our curriculum and how we're doing as a whole when we see that every year. If we were seeing big fluctuations year to year, that would be more reflective of the students, different students, but seeing a steady increase year after year should reflect what we're seeing within our curriculum and what we're doing for all our students. So we have a similar pattern of increase at both fifth and eighth grade. This next chart gives similar information for math. Again, our students currently this year are performing at much higher levels than the students 8 years ago, with some steady increases from 8 years ago to now. In both these grade levels, I just chose fourth and seventh grade as different groups of students. You do see a little bit of leveling off in the last year or so. And that could well be a reflection of we've had implemented a new math curriculum a number of years ago. We saw some big increases, and now it might be a little bit of leveling off, and we'll need to monitor that over the next few years to make sure that there's not big dips, but we want to keep seeing increases. And we are seeing this a similar pattern here at most all grade levels. A lot of increase a few years ago and now kind of leveling off a little bit, but still, as we saw from the other data, maintaining a high level of achievement. Any questions on those? All right, another way to look at growth over time is not to look at all the different students, all kids, you know, eighth grade for 8 years in a row, but to follow a cohort of students. We're going to take a look at three groups of students here, the current or most recent 10th graders. They're now coming in as 11th grade. The most recent 10th graders had been in third grade when we started this round of assessments. This graph illustrates the average spring scores for that group of students from when they were back in second grade. Their scores as second graders, as third graders, as fourth graders, and so on. Keep in mind, some students moved in and out of that class over time, but when I went back and looked at that data, more than 70% of the students who are currently in eighth or just finished 10th grade had also been here in second grade. So the majority of them are the same group. There are some who come in and out over time, but the group majority of them are the same group. And what we can see in here is that each group definitely shows improvement. Each group is expanding their achievement above the national norm as they go further. And in a very small way, the groups that come along later are coming up a little bit higher than the group ahead of them. So the eighth graders are a little bit higher than the current 10th graders in each grade that they have assessed. The next chart gives similar information on math, taking a look at the most recent 9th, 8th, and 7th grade groups. Tracking there, all of them had been tested in 2nd grade and then following those groups as they have moved on. Here we see an even more dramatic increase above the national norm. You may notice in both the 8th and 7th grade groups this kind of dramatic peak at 5th grade that then kind of dropped down at 6th grade but then continued going up. We started seeing that a few years ago, and we took a look at it and addressed it, communicated with the NWA test company, really came to the conclusion, and something many districts across Minnesota have done the same thing. I didn't find this out till after we had made this decision. But our curriculum through middle school, our fifth graders were really reaching very high levels on this test that were truly becoming inflated as we learned that there is a split. The NWA MAP program has two math tests. They have a 2-5 test recommended for elementary and a 6-plus test recommended for secondary. The two tests actually pull from the same test item bank, but the 6-plus pulls more higher-end items, particularly going into algebra and probability. The 2-5 test doesn't pull as many of those high-end items, so many of our high-achieving fifth graders were kind of topping out on that 2-5 test. So this year, we made a decision, and we had our fifth graders all take the 6-plus test instead of the 2-5 test. There was a little nervousness, but then we found out many other districts across the state and across the country were starting to do the same thing. What is happening, the scores weren't dramatically different, but I think that they were a little more reflective of the students' true ability. They're a little bit lower than they were fifth grade, but not significantly. I think that we will not see this kind of peak at fifth grade and drop at sixth grade. It'll be a little bit more leveled off. The other thing that's important is that teachers were getting more valid information on their students from that fall test by taking the 6-plus, and I think it turned out to be a good decision. But that was something we saw by looking at patterns in data like this, that peak at fifth grade and drop at sixth grade, when we knew our kids weren't, their achievement wasn't lower, they were learning more, but the test was somehow not reflecting what they really knew at fifth grade. Any questions on that? Okay. Another very important part of something we get out of this NWA MAP test is individual growth targets. The company is able to provide growth targets for each student, and that growth target, we set a target in spring, and it's based on the student's previous spring scores. And how the company does this is by taking the student's score in the spring, let's say, for example, a third grader scores a 200 on the reading test. The company evaluates all third graders across the country who are at 200 on the third grade test, and then how did those kids do when they hit fourth grade in the spring, and what's the average score for those kids when they were in the fourth grade? That then becomes the target for a third grader who had a 200, and that then becomes their fourth grade target. So a third grader who had a 210 in the spring will have a different target based on how all the third graders who were at 210 did and then how they did in fourth grade. So they're individual targets based on average achievement for kids who started at the same place. So what we look at is each student has their individual target. We then look at the end of the spring, how many, what percent of our students met that target? And that is what these numbers show. What percent of our students met their individual targets based on achievement from their compared to students at a similar starting point. The national average would be about 50% meeting their targets. That's how it's defined, because that's the average achievement. And in most areas, we have very close to or well above 50%, but not the same everywhere. And this is a number that does fluctuate a little bit from year to year, and it is something we can look at. But what's important, what I find really important, many teachers find important, is they use this information, they use those targets to help students set goals for the end of the year. And that can be really useful. You know, what would be expected growth? What is typical growth or average growth to help students set goals as they work through the year? There are a couple numbers that are starred here. As I said, we're looking at spring to spring targets. Second grade doesn't have a first grade spring score, so they have a separate target based on their fall of second grade. So they have a fall to spring target, which will be slightly different. And as I mentioned, those fifth graders jumped to a different level of the math test, so we use targets based on fall to spring to keep it within the same level of the test, which was important.
Have you, I mean, looking at this, you see eighth grade math.
Mm-hmm.
It's a pretty significantly lower number.
Yes.
Reaching potential. Have you guys analyzed what that?
There has been some discussion about that because that has popped out, and it's actually that has been like that for a couple years in a row. There is a strong emphasis at all our grade levels that preparation, a lot of it is geared towards our MCA tests, and our state test at eighth grade is very heavy algebra, a strong, strong focus on algebra, and we do find our kids are doing well on the MCA grade 8 math test. The NWA MAP test is a little broader based. Algebra is part of it, but it's also covering many other topics. And in talking at the district level, there is some discussion. Do we need to look at, we want to make sure we don't go away from what we're preparing for that state test because that's very high profile and we want to do well on that. But maybe we need to also implement some other, a little bit more of all of the other geometry, probability. Because that score does look concerning, but we also know we have high achievement overall. So that it is something that has initiated discussion, which is something we need to do.
Thank you.
Sharon, I got a question for
yeah.
you. When you guys look at the targets, too, do you look at ever the breakdown of kids in the lower 25th percentiles targets versus the middle bubble target mm-hmm. versus the high end, and where in there are they, you know, are most of the high-end kids meeting it? Are most of the low-end kids meeting it? Or is it just?
Yes, we do take a look at it. I take a look at it. It may not always go very far. Many classroom teachers do look at it. There is often concern when teachers have a lot of high-achieving kids. They're very worried, well, if they're already high-achieving, are they may not hit their targets because they're already scoring so high. Well, their targets are compared to other students who are also scoring high. So we need to have those kids show at least average growth. And we do need to look at that for our gifted programs for our high-achieving kids. Our lower-achieving students often have very high growth targets, but those are based on what kind of growth did other low-achieving kids demonstrate. So they shouldn't be unreasonable growth targets, but we should see all those different groups showing growth, meeting growth, absolutely. And that needs to be looked at.
And for the most part, is it a pretty even disbursement across them, or?
Yeah, I believe it is. At times and in certain grade levels, it can fluctuate, but I don't have any data right
now.
No,
I'm just curious if mm-hmm. that's stuff that's looked at.
It is looked, I know, by individual teachers. I don't know how much at the building level.
I have a quick question as well.
Yeah.
When planning for meeting a student's growth target, could teachers look and say, you know, little Laura isn't doing very well at probability, but she's doing great in algebra and geometry. Can they pull that
yes.
figure as well?
Okay. And we'll get to that in a minute.
Okay.
Yes, thank you. All right, we'll do a quick looking at, you asked about breaking out some of this growth. I did take a look at breaking out some of our demographics because that is also part of our federal accountability. And we want to make sure that all the various subgroups, not just our whole student population showing growth, but each group within our subpopulation showing some similar growth. So we have some demographic ethnic groups. And in reading, we have a very similar percentage across the board. In fact, all our minority groups showing more growth or higher percentage showing growth than our white kids. And in a lot of ways, that's a good thing. We want to look at closing our achievement gap. And part of closing that achievement gap is to show growth. Mm-hmm. So our minority students definitely showing growth in reading. In math, we have a few differences. We have our Native Americans showing the highest proportion of growth, but we do have one group just below 50%, and that is our Hispanic students. So that would be something that we need to keep an eye on and make sure that they're demonstrating growth in math as well as they are in reading, or as well as the other students.
What's your minimum reporting number of students? Like the one student,
well, this,
five students?
This is why we put all grades combined, because if I had to break it out by grade levels, we would have a lot of minority groups that don't have enough. 10 is my 10, personal okay. minimum.
And I have a question. So, so of these minority groups, are there any that have a higher percentage of ELL students?
Probably.
And so does that affect their and the ELL reading the math problems?
The ELL students are in this group, as are special ed, yes. So definitely there would be some groups in here with a higher proportion of those, yes.
Thank you.
Another set of demographic groups are some of those special service groups that you just mentioned. We have special ed students, English language learners. Poverty is another group of students, and they are represented by students who receive free or reduced lunch based on family economic situation. And then also I threw in male and female, because that's another group that is often asked, make sure that both male and female students are showing similar levels of achievement. Within reading, we do have some differences. The special education students are the lower group there, just under 50%, not significantly below, but just under. But that's also the group that would have all your students who have reading disabilities. So there may well, the special education group will also include students with speech issues, maybe physical impairments. It's a fairly broad group, so it's not all learning disabilities, but all your learning disability students would be in that group. Now, the English language learners, they're the group showing the most growth, and that is outstanding. We want to see that. Those students need to show above average growth if they're going to have a chance of catching up to their English speaking peers. So we are seeing within our English language learners that we are showing a good amount of growth, which they need. In math, it's very similar across all those groups, which is a good thing to see. There's no group really lagging there in their math growth. And I'll mention quickly, all that data that we just looked at is looking at, have they met as much growth as other kids around the country? And that would be average growth. But in many cases, we would need to see more than average growth. For example, our ESL students or any students who are falling behind, we need to see accelerated growth for those students. And that's something we are now starting to look at more closely. Not just average growth may not be enough for many of our students. We want to see accelerated growth. And something we have had access to this year, you may have heard reference to our using the TIES system, a data warehouse, which there's an IQ system that allows teachers to have quick and easy access to many kinds of reports. One of the reports that the TIES system has put out is they include the average growth targets that NWA has done, but TIES has also created an accelerated growth target based on 50% more than average and made that easily available for our teachers, so our teachers can kind of look, well, for this student, what is appropriate growth, what kind of growth. They have an average target, but also have an accelerated growth target. We're not reporting on accelerated growth yet, but that's something as our teachers get more familiar with trying to help establish appropriate goals for their students that we may well start looking at. All right, subscores. You asked a few minutes ago about understanding or being able to look at identifying do they need one certain area more than another. The NWA MAP test does provide subscores, and they are aligned with our state tests as well. So these same strands are the same strands that are in the state tests. For reading, we have literature, informational text, and foundations and vocabulary. Because I get the question a lot, what's the difference between literature and informational text? In a nutshell, literature is your fiction, and informational text is your nonfiction. So there are, every student receives a score in each of these strands each time they take the test. And taking a look at these scores, I've given you a quick look at the average scores, both fall and reading, for each grade level in each of these strands. But what's really important is that teachers have access to these scores for every student, and they have averages for their classroom. And that is what teachers really can use if they get this information right in the fall. Is their class real different from a class they had before? Is there a strand that they're really strong in and another one they're not strong in? Do they have a few students who are all very similar in one strand but really struggling with another strand? Teachers can really use that information to identify what their students need, make instructional decisions, and help students set individual goals for which area do they need to work on the most. So those were the reading strands. In math, there are four strands, again, aligned to our state tests and our state standards. And again, very similar kind of information that teachers can have access to right away when their kids take the test. Does that answer your question on the strands?
Thank you.
All right. All right, just a quick summary of this NWA MAP test before I move on to a couple others. As we've seen the last few years, we have strong achievement, well above the national norm, and our students are showing growth. But it's important to remember that this is only one piece of student information. There is quite a bit more that goes on in the classroom, other types of assessments that can give a broader picture of a student, not only for individual students, but a broader picture of our curriculum and everything we do. But this is one piece. It's tangible. It's easy to work with. But it's not the whole. It's not everything we have on kids. We have quite a bit more. All right, we're going to jump gears to that ACT series. There's an Explore test at grade 8 and a Plan test at grade 10. These are developed, created by the ACT company, and they're tests that align with and are linked to the ACT. This year for the last couple of years, we have been giving the Explore to all 8th graders and the Plan to all 10th graders, and it has been provided through the state. The state has provided funds to do that. We have not had to pay for it. It's been optional. Many districts around the state did it, but not all. We haven't been part of it. The ACT test has not been required. We have many students take it, but not all, so I will not be reporting on any ACT results. We will get a summary report for our graduating seniors later this summer, and that's something we may bring back later. But for right now, we'll have only 8th grade and 10th grade, and how that leads up to preparing for the ACT. The results for these Explore and Plan, we could look at average scale scores, but we're not going to do that. We're going to take a look at what percent of our students are meeting what the company calls college or career readiness benchmarks. On these tests, they're identifying a score at which these students are on track to be successful, not only on the ACT, but that way be successful in college-level coursework. These are not scores that kids need to get into college. That's not what this is about, but it's a score. What is the score at which kids are expected to be successful doing college-level work when they get there? So here's some scores for the eighth graders. They took this in the fall. It was last October. And what percent of Farmington students are meeting those college readiness benchmarks? The orange columns are scores for Farmington students the last 3 years. And the national norm is shown right next to that. In English, math, reading, and science, we're showing a higher percent of kids as compared to the national norm meeting those college readiness benchmarks. English seems to be our strength. Math has been increasing steadily the last few years. Reading might stand out. It looks like there's a drop there. The company changed the college readiness benchmark this year, and that is why national went down as well. So you really can't compare the reading or the science. They changed the science benchmark also, but the science benchmark decreased, allowing more kids to be identified as ready. So the reading one became more difficult. The science one became a little bit easier. If you wanted information on that, I could talk to you separately about that. There's a lot of details into why they did that. But the bottom line is, in both cases, we're maintaining well above the national norm for percent of students reading those college readiness benchmarks. But we'd still like to see more kids achieving at that level and increasing. So this is eighth grade. And then this was the grade 10 plan test, similar percent of students at 10th grade who are demonstrating their achievement is at a level to be successful on college level material. Similarly, English is our strength. Math had gone up a little bit, dropped back just a little bit this year. Reading, that change in the reading and science affected both the grade 8 and the grade 10 tests, so it's hard to compare those to previous years.
Well, it seems like we're falling behind from math, in math from the grade 8 to the grade 10 as well. 53% down to 40%.
It seems like that, again, we have some, not all the students are exactly the same over two-year change, but it is a slightly tougher test, so it does seem that we're losing ground a little bit, but nationally those numbers also go down. So it is something to look at. I saw the same thing too. All right, part of why I wanted to share this with you is that next year there is a change. I told you that the state had allowed us to take those grade 8 and grade 10 Explore. It was optional, but the state paid for it. This coming year, the state is mandating all 8th graders take the Explore, all 10th graders take the plan, and all 11th graders will take the ACT. And it's part of it, that is now part of the state testing system. So all students grade 8, 10, and 11 will be taking part of those series. The grade 8 and 10 Explore and Plan will again be in the fall. They'll be November this year. All 11th graders will take the ACT in April. It'll be part of their state testing. And what will be interesting about this for the first time, for those of you who have followed these tests for a while, one thing that has been hard, the NWA MAP tests we just went through, they have national norms that we compare ourselves to. But there's no state averages for NWA MAP. We've always wanted Minnesota averages for NWEA. For the ACT and plan, we have national norms, but no state averages. For the MCA, we've had state averages, but no national comparison. For the first time, this assessment at grades 8, 10, and 11 will give us state data and national data, something we've hoped to have for a while. So hopefully we'll be okay with what it tells us.
So I have a question regarding the juniors taking the ACT.
Yeah.
Is that a cost to the district? Are they providing it?
The state. This is part of the state test, yes. It will be free to all our 11th graders. All of them will take it. They are welcome to take it more than that one time.
Right,
and that
but
would
they, everybody has the opportunity
everybody,
to have free ACT
Everybody
test.
Has the opportunity to take the ACT for free.
Oh. Hoorah.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
One question, too, I'd like to ask.
Yeah.
I know that they gave us the opportunity to also take the PSAT as well with the ACT and the pre-ACT. Mm-hmm. So will they still administer the pre-ACT kind of maybe in the fall and then do the ACT in the spring to kind of set them up for the ACT in the spring? Or can they still take the PSAT as well?
The pre-ACT is actually the Explore and the Plan, which we've been talking about. The PSAT, which was offered last year, our district will still offer that, because that has been a valuable thing. But I believe that was something, if we chose to do it, families had to pay for that.
Mm-hmm.
So that'll be an option, still available, but it's not free. It's not part of the state system at this point. All right.
Now,
yes.
The state did away with the grad test, right? And the replacement is essentially the ACT program?
Yeah, that's not as easy as that. The grad requirements are still there. The grad test is still an option to meet those grad requirements. There are other ways. Taking the ACT is a way to meet the grad requirements, and there are other tests available, such as the ASVAB or the ACCUPLACER. They have now allowed multiple ways to pass that requirement. Now that the ACT is going to be offered to all students, about the only students who might have any need to take the grad test would be kids who are absent the day the ACT was offered, or for some other reason chose not to take it. So the grad is still there, and there is a graduation requirement, but they don't have to take the grad test, which would had been in the past.
So if they don't take anything, that they still have to do something before they graduate?
If students somehow manage to be absent and not take any of these tests, they would not get their diploma.
Just making sure. Yeah. Yep, I know there was a big to-do when they did away with the grad. Yep. That.
Yep, there are still some requirements to demonstrate.
All right. Thank you.
No problem. All right, last slide. General summary. We have a lot of information on our students, a lot of data. Through multiple measures, we see that we do have continued high level of achievement compared to the national norm. We have majority of our students showing average or more than average growth from year to year. And now we are seeing an increased emphasis at the state level on this college and career readiness and through the ACT system. So we will continue to have more and more data on our students.
And when did you say the ACT scores from this year's students will be?
The company provides a summary on the graduating class, and we usually get it late August.
And that will come back to the board then?
Yeah.
Thank you.
I will make sure it does.
Thank you.
All right.
Are there any questions?
Did you guys take the ACT?
I took the SAT, actually.
SAT.
Yep.
I took both the ACT and the SAT.
But why would you do that to yourself?
Overachievers. Right, thank you so much for your time. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Our next item is the designation of the subcommittee for the superintendent goals. And so to that end, I appoint myself, Tara Lee, and Julie Singwall to begin working on those. Are there any questions? Then I'll take a motion.
Make a motion to accept reports and communications as presented.
Second.
Motion by Treacle, second by Sasser. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Now we have our administrative action, and our first item is the resolution approving the ISD 917 health and safety program budget with Superintendent Haugen.
Okay, you have it in your packet. Slow to, I got logged out. Sorry. Okay. Trying to think of something even snappy to say about it. It's something that happens every year with 917 because 917 doesn't have people to levy, but yet they have buildings that serve our students. So this is how we manage to get dollars for 917. And we also get to use some of the health and safety dollars as well through that means. So it's really a routine item we do every year.
All right. Are there any questions? And then I'll take a motion.
Make a motion to adopt the resolution approving Intermediate School District 917's health and safety program budget, authorizing the inclusion of a proportionate share of those projects in the district's application for health and safety revenue as presented.
Second.
Motion by Singwald, second by Cordes. Roll call vote, please.
Yes.
Yes.
Sasser.
Aye.
Singwall.
Yes.
Treacle.
Yes.
Lee.
Yes. Motion carries. Next, we have the item to establish our school board and committee meeting dates, and the attached list of meeting dates is based on the same schedule as this year for school board meetings, the second and fourth Mondays of each month, except for July and December, when there will be only one meeting. Are there any questions?
One quick question. Sorry. Go ahead. Ladies first.
Madam Chair, in the past, it's traditionally we've ended up having a school board meeting during spring break, and I'm curious if that's covered, if that's this year as well. We've made it work in the past, but it's kind of difficult sometimes for board members as well as I think for the community to be aware of what's going on during that week. I haven't been able to double check the calendar though yet.
I don't know if it's on spring break again. Is that?
It's no different than July, in my opinion, or December.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's going to be times in the year, and I think that's why it's just important that we publish our agendas in an appropriate amount of time so that people have an opportunity to at least be aware of what we're going to discuss and further questions to us if need be.
Okay.
All right. Did you have
Actually, I just remembered that I did research it already, and my question's already been answered. So,
all right.
Sorry.
Then I'll take a motion.
I'll make a motion to set school board meetings for the 2014-15 school year on the second and fourth Mondays of each month, except for July and December.
Second.
Motion by Cordes, second by Treacle. Roll call vote, please.
Yes.
Cordes.
Yes.
Sasser.
Yes.
Singwall.
Yes.
Treacle.
Yes.
Lee.
Yes. Motion carries. Next, we have the adoption of the 2014-2015 budget with Mr. Carl Kohlmark. Your last budget, how are you feeling?
Good. What else can you say? You know, this is, I think, the 27th annual budget that I brought to school boards for adoption, and it's hard to believe that much time has passed, but each and every budget has its own uniqueness, and we're excited to bring forward this particular budget for the fiscal 14-15 school year, in particular because we have a balanced general fund. In fact, a budget where the revenue exceeds expenditures by about $350,000, which will certainly help improve our fund balance issue by about 0.5%. Now, we did visit this budget. We had some discussion a couple of weeks ago, and I did mention to you that we had a couple of corrections that we needed to make. One was a column title for the 2013-14 expenditures in the general fund. I also mentioned that we would be modifying the community education fund to add some small amount of revenue and expenditures related to some early childhood family education legislative changes. At the meeting, I also indicated that because of the USDA formulas, we would be required to have the school board, when you adopt the budget, also adopt an increase in our lunch ticket prices by 10 cents. And what that will do, it will set the elementary prices for next year at $2.45, the middle school $2.60, senior high school $2.65, and the adult lunch would be $3.45. The other thing that I have to bring to your attention and walk through with you is referred to as the health and safety five-year budget plan. This is something that we're required to do statutorily. In order to levy the property taxes for the health and safety needs in the district. It's something that they changed a few years back. You will have in your materials a 7-page document, the last 5 pages being a number of columns of different categories for health and safety. And I'm gonna just quickly walk through what those different categories are. They're titled at the top of each column on each year. A number, for example, 347 are referred to as physical hazards. Those are playground surfaces, bleacher repair, and things of that nature. Number 349, other hazardous materials, polychlorinated biphenyls, fuel tanks, infectious waste, lead and water, things like that. Category 352, environmental health and safety management. That's who we pay IEA to do a lot of the administering of our health and safety programs. Category 358, asbestos removal. Number 363 is fire safety. That's inspections, addressing code violations, testing and servicing sprinklers, strobes, horns, and things of that nature. And then finally, number 366, which is indoor air quality, code violations and heating, ventilating, and air conditioning upgrades to meet codes and standards. But as you look at each of the 5 years, and I'll just hold it up. I know you know how to read these, and this wouldn't have made for a very good presentation on the television monitor. But you'll notice that annual reoccurring things make up the majority every year, over and over and over and over. The same type of science, technology, personal protective equipment, elevator inspections, playground surface material like wood chips. The list goes on and on, and I don't think I need to go through every one of these items. In fiscal 2015, the only thing that's unique about that is that we've set $25,000 in place for North Trail Elementary HVAC commissioning. What that is we have engineers come in and make sure that our heating ventilating systems are functioning properly. You'll also notice, in addition to the annual recurring on each of these, there's 3 lines that relate to Farmington Elementary and Aiken Road Elementary. For our alternative facility bond payments, and that was something that was approved a couple of years ago to upgrade our heating, ventilating, and systems in both schools, as well as some asbestos at Farmington Elementary School. So as you look at each year, they're pretty consistent. The only change, other than that North Trail Elementary commissioning and the change in the debt service each year for the alt facility bonds, the majority of this is annual recurring items. So I would like to ask if there's anything you would like to ask me about these particular items.
Are there any questions?
Madam Chair.
Yes.
The items on this list are mandated that we have these inspections, correct? The majority
correct.
Of them?
Yes.
Is there any way, I'm just thinking recently we had the update with security, school security for the buildings. Does that fall under this jurisdiction at all?
I'm not aware that that would qualify at okay. this point. I can do some further follow-up, but I am not aware of that being the case.
I was just kind of curious because that seems like it should logically fit, but I know our funds for those assessments have come from other means. So.
Well, I know the state took that up this year. I don't remember if they passed anything on that. Didn't. Yeah.
It's changed.
Yeah, I know that was discussed heavily, but.
We can continue to pursue that. We are working still on putting together that security report that helps put it in a more manageable size so that we can all look at it and get a pretty good idea of what our needs are and what some potential funding options are for us moving forward.
Okay. Thank you.
Are there any other questions? Then I'll take a motion.
I'll move to adopt the recommended fiscal year 14-15 budget as presented, the capital expenditure health and safety five-year plan, and food service 10-cent lunch ticket price increase.
Second.
Motion by Singwald, second by Cordes. Roll call vote, please.
Lee?
Yes.
Cordes? Yes.
Sasser?
Yes.
Singwald?
Yes.
Friegel?
Yes.
Lee?
Yes. Motion carries. Next, we have the approval of the Aiken Road Elementary Locker Plan.
Thank you again, Madam Chair, Superintendent, School Board members. If you recall, in April, I brought to the school board in a planning session and with some recommendations to look at the use of the remaining $500,000 of bond construction resources. You did authorize increasing Farmington Elementary for $100,000 to clean up some remaining items in that school, as well as approximately $100,000 for the Farmington High School well and sprinkler system. We know we have a number of other items that of need in the district as are well documented, but one of the things that we have been looking at, trying to address, are the Aiken Road lockers. Something that, number one, they are in terrible condition. Number two, they do impede some of the sight lines and vision of people walking around the corridors, and the size issue. And we have spent some time, I've been working with the Center for Efficient School Operations. They're kind of a company that helps us with some of these smaller construction projects, as well as the principal, Lisa Reichelt, in trying to find a really good solution. One of the concerns when we had brought forward in part of our bids earlier was a different type of steel locker, again, that would be in the corridors by the classrooms, taking them out of the commons areas. A couple of concerns with that is, number one, they tend to develop rust because you get a lot of wet boots that tend to be set in these, and they make noise. They're loud in the corridors, and also the concern with they would shake and disturb some of the technology that's established on the walls of the classrooms. That was part of the reason for rejecting that alternate bid at Aiken Road at that point in time. Well, we are coming forward this evening with a recommendation for your consideration to remove those existing lockers in those commons areas and put in 700 lockers in the classroom corridors. It's a manufacturer by the initials of CTB. The colors for these, I won't call them lockers, a better term for it would be cubbies because they don't have doors to slam on them. It's got a color called Fusion Maple that is similar to the shelves in the library, so it's somewhat coordinated. With a tan base, they'd be a height of 5 foot tall with a width of 1 foot. The material is a laminate top and sides, a stronger laminate top and shelf, and then a plastic base that's kind of curved at the base so that it can trap any moisture and won't cause any kind of deterioration in that laminate material on the sides and top. In this proposal, the existing lockers would be demoed in July with flooring restored to match or somehow color coordinated in a very pleasant way. And then in mid-August, when all of the manufacturing of those cubbies are completed, they would be installed. It would only be a matter of a couple of days to do that installation. Now, the cost for this is $127,000 for everything. The rejected bids a year or so ago were $135,000, and that did not include other soft costs that would have gone along with it. So this is a good $20,000 to $30,000 lower price tag for what we feel is a better solution. So I'm going to throw that out there for your comments and thought.
Any questions?
As you said, this includes refurbishing the floors underneath where the lockers currently exist?
Yes.
Does it include furniture? I know there was a plan at one point in time, they were talking about putting furniture in there to make that more of a common space.
You know, this particular price did not contemplate that, but I'm sure it's something that we will want to do and address once we get this completed.
So currently just leaving that open space is what the...
For the time being.
Right.
Yes.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions? And I'll take a motion.
I'll move to approve the use of the remaining bond funds to address the Aiken Road Elementary locker plan for $127,000 as presented.
Second.
Motion by Singwald, second by Treacle. Roll call vote, please.
Yes.
Portis?
Yes.
Sasser?
Yes.
Singwald?
Yes.
Treacle?
Yes.
Lee?
Yes. Motion carries. Thank you very much. Our next item is the approval of the Community Education Classroom Support Personnel Contract for 2014-2016 with Ms. Mary Ann Thomas.
Thank you, Chair Lee, members of the school board, Superintendent Haugen, and members of the community. I'm happy to present to you the 2014-16 contract for our community ed classroom support personnel. We have reached a tentative agreement with them after a number of meetings over the course of the year. This is a group that represents about 50 employees in the bargaining unit. It's about a $950,000 contract, and the increase was about $53,000 over the course of the 2 years. The highlights of the contract included a very slight increase to the dental contribution, $158 increase to the health insurance contribution for those employees who choose to go in our high deductible Plan C. That's in year two of the contract. We also did a few language changes, more for clarification than anything. We reformatted the contract so it's a little bit easier to understand because it represents four different programs within this group, and they all have slightly different processes, and so we just cleaned up the contract so it's easy to read for each of the four programs. We tweaked the snow day language, a little bit with regard, which tweaked the language with regard to bereavement leave, clarified how two extra holidays are paid. They've already been negotiated, but we just clarified who gets them and when, what the process is for that. And that our vacation is accrued and used in hours, not days. A lot of these people are part-time, and it's a lot easier for them and for us to monitor their vacation use in hours. And then we added some flexibility when we have a instructor who goes on a leave of absence that an assistant could take over that position if she or he is otherwise qualified, but not lose their seniority in their regular job. So a number of good things came out of this contract. I'd be happy to answer any questions. Otherwise, you have the resolution before you.
Are there any questions? Then I'll take a motion.
I'll make a motion that the school board, that the school board of Independent School District 192 approve the collective bargaining agreement with the International Union of Operating Engineers, Local Number 70, non-certified classroom personnel in K-Connection, We Tigers, Stepping Stones, and ECFE programs for the contract period of July 1st, 2014 to June 30th of 2016 as presented.
Second.
Motion by Treacle, second by Sasser. Roll call vote, please.
Yes.
Portis?
Yes.
Sasser?
Yes.
Singwald?
Yes.
Treacle?
Yes.
Lee?
Yes. Motion carries.
Thank you
very much. Next, we have our policy action. So I will turn that over to Superintendent Haugen.
All right. Thanks, Madam Chair, members of the board. It's really hard to believe we're at this point. The 800s and 900s. It just seems like a long time ago that we sat down and said, hey, would it be a good idea if we did all of our policies?
Are we starting over at the next meeting then? Or?
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, you're so right. And I do want to thank everyone, thank the members of the cabinet, and especially Lori for all the work they did reviewing word by word, you know, all of these things and matching them to our current practice and trying to decide whether that's something we could go with MSBA or if there was something that needed to be different. And for all of your work, listening to these at, you know, every work session that I think about we've had this year, and then and dealing it sometimes with some that just weren't quite right, and we made some different decisions along the way, so thank you for your attention to that. But you also have to know the legislature was just in session, and they've already have made changes to some of these, but it won't be now wholesale change. We'll be bringing you the two or three that they made changes to, and then we will be updating, and that will be our process now. MSBA will be a full partner in this, you know, in helping us keep all these things up to date. So really, really pleased. Just thank everyone where we're at. And so for tonight, we do have the final reading of the 800s and 900s.
Are there any questions? Then I'll take a motion.
I'll make a motion to adopt MSBA policy series 800 and 900 as listed above.
I'll second.
Motion by Cordes, second by Beam. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. And next we have our policies for deletion. Are there any questions about those? Then I'll take a motion.
I'll make a motion to delete policy DM, KDE, FB, BCFA, and KBA that are being replaced by the MSBA model policy series 800 and 900.
Second.
Motion by Singwald, second by Trico. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Next, we have our board remarks, and I'll start with Andrew.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'd like to thank all those who presented today. I really liked that they added the ACT as going to be paid for our students to take that. I know that that's a, I think it cost me around $50 to take mine total with the writing and everything that the requirements, and I did take it twice, so there's $100 right there, and if they allow us to do that for our students, that'd be awesome. I mean, it'll keep costs low. And then I'd also like to congratulate with due days and everything, new Miss Farmington, Mauricia Pacheco. She was crowned Miss Farmington, so I'd just like to congratulate her. Thank you.
Thank you, Natalie.
Yes, he kind of stole mine. I wanted just to recognize and congratulate the newly crowned Farmington royalty, and excited to see what they will do this year. So,
great, thanks. Board Member Cordes.
I would just like to thank the student board members for their service over the past couple of months. You guys really brought something great to the board, and I'm happy we're going to continue having student board members in the future. I know it's a couple weeks late, but I want to congratulate all the graduates, the Farmington High School class of 2014. And I want to thank the 11 people who participated in the due days bed race. The school district got fourth. I'm not going to mention how many teams were in the race, but just thank the board members, superintendents, Bill Cheeta, Lynn Bauman, Amanda Virch, Allison Lauby, and Lisa Lippold, who all participated.
Fantastic.
Thank you. Ms. Beam?
I was just going to thank Carl Kohlmark, as he's stepped out.
No, he's just hiding.
Oh, he's hiding back there for his service. And, you know, thank you for all the work that you've done, and looking forward to a retirement party here soon.
Mm-hmm. Oh. Member Singwald.
Just want to reiterate all the things that have been mentioned so far. I mean, this is kind of a fun time of year. It's fast and furious, and great times to celebrate stuff, and it just seems to fly by so quick. My thanks actually go out to the district staff that, although our buildings are not in session, so to speak, even at our last board meeting, coming in and watching all of the lockers being opened and worked on, I mean, the buildings are not closed, essentially. You know, there's a lot of activities that still continue to happen in our buildings, but it's also that time when our district can go in and make repairs as needed and whatnot, and there's a lot of staff that work very hard in the summer months to ensure that the start of this next school year, we are as fully prepared as we can be. So just to recognize that, and they are working in buildings that are oftentimes less than desirable environmental conditions because they're doing good cost savings also, so no air or so thank you to those staff, and just to the class of 2014, it's very fun having gone to a number of grad parties to watching our district students become future leaders in our community is awesome to see in all walks of life, and to see them take that next step is awesome. And a thanks to our district in helping these young adults become our new community members, so to speak. So
thank you, Member Treacle.
Well, you guys kind of already put it out there, but thank you to our school board, you know, student school board members. You guys have been a great contribution. I appreciate what you have done. I'm really disappointed in you that you did not show up Friday to help us.
They were both working. I already tried.
Working, I know. Me too.
Very, very disappointed. Oh, you missed the way we lost with style.
Yeah.
As we were clearly, I mean, we had lost, the team had finished the line before we even got to leave the other end.
Well,
right?
There was no
as we're going down, Miss Singwald.
No one,
Jake left that hanging.
No, it's all right. It's a matter of public record. May as well just get it out there and admit it. Let's not live in denial. Miss Singwald jumps up on the bed and surfs it in. And it was I got a really cool picture posted on Facebook and Twitter.
Her teenage daughter. Yep,
so. A couple of them, yes. I got lectured about how I embarrassed them. And
oh, no. One of them, I think, said you're weird.
I hope the picture ends up in the paper.
Yes, front page.
A great
front
cover page. So.
6 years of last place. I mean, hey.
We didn't get last place
last year. We were not.
Third out of six last year.
Yeah, we did good.
We've outdone city council, so let's just call it that.
There we go. There we go.
They've only run it twice. I've been in that thing six times, so we have outdone them.
Did you have anything else?
No, I think everything else has been said. Thank you.
Go ahead.
Well, I can't help but look at the consent agenda and realize that we still have a lot of things going on in the district, even though it's summer in a couple weeks, extended school year starts, and there are many teachers in preparation for that, and I want to thank them for their hard work during the summer to help our students that need a little extra help in the summer and help support those families as well. So thank you for your dedicated time through the summer as well.
And I just want to congratulate our superintendent for the award he received tonight, and thank you for all the work you put in, and thank you to Carl. School board student members, all of that, and thanks. I was going to thank Julie for helping us lose with style. And I wanted to say happy birthday to board member Laura Bean, whose birthday is today. Yeah. And Jake's going to sing for us now.
I'll pass.
With that, I'll take a motion to adjourn.
I'll move to adjourn at 7:42 p.m.
Second.
Motion by Singwald, second by Morris. All in favor?
Aye.
Meeting's adjourned.